Now, we're going to need some room to do this last one, so I'm going to remove myself from the image, guys, so we have more room to work with. Okay. So, actually, come back. So, actually, I'm going to stay in the image, guys, so that we can work on this. So, the last force is the force that exists when two nonpolar covalent compounds are interacting. So we have two nonpolars. Now this last force goes by a ton of different names. One name that we usually give to it is called London dispersion forces. That's one name that it can have. Another name for it is van der Waals force. And then a third name that it could have is induced dipole. Okay, so just remember, this last force can be called any one of these three. The main name for it is London dispersion, but it can also be called one of the other two. We're going to say this force exists anytime we have nonpolar compounds. So we could have CCl4 interacting with CH4. And there's a few things we need to know about this last force. One, that this force is the weakest force. Also, we need to realize that every compound, no matter what it is, has this force. This is a force that's present in all compounds. So water's main intermolecular force, stronger intermolecular force, would be hydrogen bonding. But it also has London dispersion. Because London dispersion is weaker, when we scan water, we'll see that a vast majority of its force comes from H bonding. And a very, very small percentage of its force comes from London dispersion. So again, remember, all compounds fundamentally have London dispersion forces. And what we should realize here, when it comes to London dispersion forces, we're going to say that compounds with London dispersion as their only force, we're going to say that the more they weigh, the greater their London dispersion will be. So these two compounds are both nonpolar, so they both fundamentally have London dispersion as their only force. CCl4's London dispersion will be greater than CH4 because CCl4 weighs more. The more you weigh, the greater your London dispersion. We're going to say the more you weigh, the more polarizable you are. Because when it comes to London dispersion, the way it works is, let's say that this blob here represents a compound, and its main force is London dispersion. Now, how can two things have an interaction to each other if they're both nonpolar? The way it works is polarizability. What's going to happen is electrons are going to spontaneously align themselves on one end of the compound. So electrons, for a split second, will move to the left side. They just randomly just do that. They're all going to move to the left side. So if all the electrons move to the left side, this side is going to become negative, partially negative. If all the electrons are leaving the right side, this side's going to become partially positive. Then what happens here is polarizability. So the compound that's nonpolar, usually for a split second, can become polar. It then comes near a compound that's strictly nonpolar. So CCl4 comes near CH4. Because this guy here becomes polar for an instant, it's going to make this compound become polar for an instant as well. This partially positive end here is going to attract electrons. So it's going to cause the electrons to shift in compound B to this side, so they're close to the partially positive charge. Then moving to the left will cause this side over here to become partially positive. Now, this happens for only an instant. Okay. And then the molecule returns back to being nonpolar. But that instant that this happens, that's where we get this interaction between nonpolar compounds. It happens for just a moment. But in that moment, that's where we have the London dispersion happening. And remember, all compounds have London dispersion. Compounds that are nonpolar have it as their main and only force. So remember, these are your major types of intermolecular forces that your professor will expect you to know. And a majority of them comes from fundamentally knowing how to draw. Ion dipole, you don't really need to know how to draw, because ion dipole exists anytime we have an ionic compound. So if we have an ionic compound and it's dissolving in a polar solvent, like water, it's going to be ion dipole. H bonding, we kind of don't need to really know how to draw either, because if H is connected to F, O, or N, it's automatically H bonding. It's when we get to dipole-dipole and London dispersion where it's important that we know how to draw, because you have to learn how to draw these compounds to be able to determine, is it a polar covalent compound or is it non-polar covalent? That's where it becomes essential to know what kind of structure we have and go over the rules for polarity.